So we have a cool new futuristic looking service tower for Falcon 9s and Falcon Heavies. And then of course Starship. Also, the Starship production facility at the port of LA has been approved.
Then we have an interesting potential cooperation in space between the US and India. And we'd also like to talk about Artemis. Ted Cruz has some interesting thoughts on the budget request from NASA for the fiscal year 2021. Then Blue Origin has opened their new facility in Huntsville, Alabama. Last but not least, we'd also like to talk about a new type of rocket engine, which might drastically reduce the fuel needs for launches into space. So stay tuned for these highly interesting developments.
Now let's start with SpaceX, our favorite company on this planet, besides Tesla, of course. So SpaceX has just unveiled renderings of their future mobile service tower for Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy. This mobile service tower will allow for vertical integration of payloads. This means attaching payloads to the rocket while the rocket is already standing vertically. Up until now, all payloads for SpaceX were mounted horizontally, the rocket then being erected only afterwards. A vertical integration would therefore open up many new potential contracts for SpaceX. And many other space agencies and launch providers had already been doing vertical integration for quite some time, so it's only fitting that SpaceX is now too going vertical in this regard. Now we assume that this move was in large part motivated by some potentially very lucrative military launch contracts. Because military launch contracts almost all require vertical integration. A really smart move by SpaceX, we have to say. Plus, the mobile service tower looks really futuristic and cool, as if it had been designed by legendary visual futurist Sid Mead. He would have been proud to see this tower, which is standing, by the way, 86 meters or 284 feet tall. Quite an impressive structure. It will have to be strong enough to withstand possible hurricanes, and we are very curious how exactly SpaceX will be doing that. Maybe by anchoring the structure with strong tethers to the ground at some anchor points drilled deep into the ground? Let's see. But in any case, this is a very good development because more contracts for SpaceX of course means more revenue, and we all want SpaceX to grow, of course. And just 3 days ago, NASA announced that the mission to 16 Psyche will take place utilizing a Falcon Heavy launched in 2022. Coincidence? Now, we're not sure if this mission will require vertical integration, but this is very good nonetheless, because this is a highly interesting mission, since 16 Psyche has huge amounts of precious metals worth $700 quadrillion. We, by the way, talked already about asteroid mining in general and about 16 Psyche in particular in this video here.
Now it's Starship time. And Starship time is often boom time. So the Starship SN1 prototype has popped during a pressurization test with liquefied nitrogen. It was a structural weakness. Probably the welding of a section got loose at those very deep cryogenic temperatures. SpaceX will identify the weak point and get better and better at every new iteration of Starship. It was actually planned to foresee the installation of a Raptor engine soon and do a static fire test with Starship SN1. But this will now have to happen with the Starship SN2 prototype. Fortunately, SN2 is progressing nicely and can therefore almost immediately continue where SN1 left off. This new rapid Starship building strategy will allow SpaceX to move on extremely fast in the case of the destruction of a prototype, the next one being almost immediately available afterwards. This approach is not only quite spectacular, but also extremely efficient. Their mantra has always been, fail often, fail hard, but learn a lot in the progress and get better and better really fast. So no need to worry. We will certainly still see the 20-kilometer test flight in 2020, maybe with SN5 or SN6. We shall see. Another excellent development for SpaceX is the approval of their Starship production facility at the port of LA.
Well, it seems that we'll see mass production of certain Starship parts, such as complete tanks, domes, and engine sections at the port of LA. These parts would then be transported to Boca Chica. Now basically we would have an outsourcing of certain aspects of Starship to the port of LA, which lies near to the SpaceX headquarters at Hawthorne, so that many smart engineers from Hawthorne could work on Starship. Now we assume that this was a major consideration point for SpaceX. And a facility more which produces Starship parts is of course really excellent, so that the Starship mass production will pick up even more speed in the coming months. Because we all want this 1,000 Starship fleet by 2050, which Elon mentioned already quite a few times, so of course we need as many facilities as possible to build all these Starships. And by the way, Elon actually re-emphasized this Starship fleet, actually calling it a Star Fleet, you know, like in Star Trek, while speaking at an Air Force Association symposium in Orlando on the 28th of February. This was an interesting discussion with Lieutenant General John Thompson, commander of the Space and Missile Systems Center, in which he went to say that a star fleet and other positive visions of the future are really achievable. But he also said that the US must not fall behind other nations in order to achieve that, and that innovation in space is really absolute key to maintain US leadership in space. So yeah, Elon really means it. If Elon talks about stuff, he usually also does it, you know? So the chances that we will see a 1,000 Starship fleet in the next 20, 30, 40 years is very high.
Meanwhile, Blue Origin is going a very different path. While SpaceX is being the rebel, the disruptor, 100% diametrically opposed to the likes of Lockheed and Boeing, Blue Origin is trying a different strategy. They want to be best friends with these companies. Therefore, Blue Origin just opened their new engine test facility in Huntsville, Alabama. There, BE-4 and BE-3U engines will be produced and tested, which are the engines for Blue Origin's new Glenn rocket, as well as the BE-7 engines for their future Blue Moon lander. Besides, Blue Origin is already cooperating with the Marshall Space Flight Center. So while SpaceX is doing their own thing, totally disrupting Boeing and Lockheed, Blue Origin is trying to partner with them, a pact with the devil, so to speak. Even though sometimes we make fun of Blue Origin because of their very slow and careful approach compared to SpaceX, we certainly welcome any kind of healthy competition for space exploration. We really hope to see more progress on the new Glenn rocket soon, so we don't always have to use the same render animation here, which everyone has been showing around for years now when talking about the new Glenn rocket.
Now talking about engines, we want to briefly mention a new type of potentially very interesting engine in the very early stages of development, which could become very interesting in the future. The so-called rotation detonation engine. A team of researchers did some simulations and released the results in the journal Physical Review E earlier this year, improving upon the existing design of this type of engine, link in the description. Now in the classical rocket engine, combustion is happening by deflagration, which means subsonic combustion propagating via heat transfer. Here, hot burning material heats the next layer of cold material and ignites it, which then ignites the next layer, and so on and so forth, all via heat propagation. Now, contrary to this, in a rotating detonation engine, the detonations continuously travel around an annular channel. This detonative combustion, contrary to deflagrative combustion, happens at supersonic speeds. But why might this type of rocket engine be so interesting for future application? Well, pretty simple, because it is theoretically up to 25% more fuel efficient than conventional deflagrative combustion. So a rocket would need 25% less fuel to carry the same payload to space, which would of course then allow more payload for less money. Now currently, of course, there are still many hurdles to be overcome for this type of engine to be built, such as overcoming the sometimes chaotic detonations and make the system work in a stable manner over extended periods of time. However, new engine research is always welcome. And if this type of rocket engine will really become viable, then we are very sure that SpaceX will be the first ones to install these engines into their vehicles.
And now, finally, a bit of space politics. Come on, people, we all love space politics, right? On our YouTube channel, we love talking about space politics. even though some people wish we wouldn't. But too many space channels are afraid of talking about space politics. So therefore, of course we have to do it. Because in the end, more often than not, politics can get in the way of space exploration, as we have been impressively demonstrated with the cancellation of the Apollo program back in the early 70s. This was, in our opinion, one of the biggest mistakes in US history. Nay, in the entirety of human history. Anyways, politics has an immense impact on space exploration. Therefore, we think it's extremely important to talk about it. So a new interesting development here is the latest speech of President Trump during his visit to India last week. Trump acknowledged the accomplishments of India in space exploration, such as the Chandrayaan moon program. We mentioned the Chandrayaan missions quite a few times in our videos. Now, why is Trump doing this? Does he suddenly love India so much? Of course, to counterbalance the growing power of China in space. India as an ally for joint space missions would be excellent news for both the US and India. We already speculated in one video that a future India crewed moon mission might actually utilize Starship. It's actually our hope that more countries than only India would actually buy Starships from SpaceX, or at least charter them, in order to carry out their own moon missions, or at least do joint moon missions together with the US. More international cooperation in space with joint Starship missions would be an excellent development. And a potential cooperation between the US and India might just be the first step into that direction.
Now, what is happening meanwhile over at Artemis? A viewer of ours, by the way, had a very amazing and funny idea what Artemis could actually stand for. Apollo Resurrection Towards Endless Money Incineration System. This is freaking hilarious, thanks Stitchum7 for coming up with this. It's funny, yet sadly true at the same time. Now, in order for Artemis to really happen, we talked in the last Space News episodes about the proposed increase in NASA's budget by as much as 12.5% for the fiscal year 2021, up to $25 billion, and even up to $28 billion in 2024 and 2025. Now, this would actually be needed in order for Artemis to have any chance to really make it, and this is also in line with estimates that the Artemis program would need around $30 billion more in additional funding until 2024 to actually make it happen. However, Senator Ted Cruz thinks it's highly unlikely that the fiscal year 2021 appropriations bill will pass this year. He said during a Space Transportation Association event at Capitol Hill on the 26th of February. He was especially critical of Democrat House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, saying that she will not allow any legislation favorable to Trump to pass the House. Now, this was unfortunately also the impression we were getting. Now, the sheer hate against Trump with which the Democratic Party seems to be infused these days will make them block and hinder everything which could be laid out as a success for Trump, even if it would be beneficial for the US. Ted Cruz said in detail, "If they treat space as a partisan football, they will destroy the bipartisan cooperation that we've had going for a number of years." Now, in the Senate, we're moving forward. I think it's very doable in the Senate. He then urged those in attendance to talk to House members and convince them to maintain bipartisanship and not let American leadership in space be on the chopping block.
This is sad, but he aptly formulated the core problem. Space exploration is being politicized and made a tool where Democrats fight Republicans or vice versa. Correct us if we are wrong, but if we were to point out one major flaw in the political system of the US, it would be the two-party system, with two extremely opposed parties sharing almost no common ground. That's a big problem in our eyes, and that's exactly why NASA is getting nowhere. Meanwhile, China will get stronger and stronger in space, while raps and dams battle each other to death. Luckily, the US has SpaceX. They can call themselves extremely lucky that this is the case, else they would fall behind China big time in the 2020s. But with SpaceX, the US will probably keep the leadership and will even extend it in a big way. Elon is really saving America's ass in space. And not only in space, but also technology-wise in general, with Tesla, the Boring Company, and Neuralink, and so on. Now, since NASA is being played ping-pong with in the US Senate, the military, meanwhile, will probably prove to be a more reliable partner to SpaceX, especially now with the newly established Space Force. We already theorized quite a few times that the military would be highly interested in utilizing Starship as a troop transporter. Isn't it funny that now, after we have speculated about it so often, Elon said in the very same Air Force Association's symposium in Orlando that Starship would be really interesting for a Space Force? Who would have thought, Yes, and we've already made this prediction here on this channel the very first time when the Space Force was announced. Just saying, you know? It was clear for us that Starship would become the vehicle of choice for Space Force. And Elon is basically re-emphasizing this, making it even clearer in our eyes that we will see a Space Force version of Starship. It's only a matter of time. And sadly, Freeman Dyson passed away on the 28th of February. We often talked about Dyson spheres and Dyson swarms in our older videos, in which we estimated the probability of alien life, or better, intelligent life in the Milky Way. And of course, Dyson's work was an invaluable contribution to theorizing about alien megastructures. His work is really important for trying to understand how super advanced Type 3 alien civilizations might look like, and how also we ourselves might actually look like in the very distant future. Hint, not anything like humans anymore. But Dyson's work also ranged to mathematics, philosophy, and quantum physics. Rest in peace, Freeman Dyson. You were one of the greatest minds of our age. And that's exactly why we need life extension technology, by the way. We are losing great minds to the condition of aging. So upgrade Gray, work faster, please. We need that stuff now.
So what do you think? Is the US political system intrinsically flawed with this two opposing party system hindering any meaningful progress with NASA?
And do you agree with us that Elon is saving the US on so many different levels? So with SpaceX in spaceflight, with Tesla in electric cars and renewable energy, and with the Boring Company for transportation and Neuralink even.
And his Hyperloop and I don't know what else. VTOL, I don't know.
We'd really like to know your opinion in the comment section.
So you just watched the JS Space Report, which we do every Monday, the commentary show where we talk about space exploration and space flight, but with a strong emphasis on space politics, because we think it's really important to talk about space politics, because no one else is doing it somehow.
So thanks for watching, and I would say, on to the future!